respondents and committed to our promise as a CIPS Manchester branch to engage more, providing tangible value to our members. So we're delighted to welcome you to our today's discussion about the future technologies in supply chain and logistics management. Among others, we will discuss and try to reply questions like which technologies will truly change the industry landscape, which technologies are just the hype versus those really making a difference, which areas should you be focusing your efforts to remain competitive, how quickly do you need to be onboarding specific technologies. To answer these questions and have a better insight of his survey on the specific area, I'm delighted to welcome as our guest speaker to our today's session, Dr. Ian Reid, Deputy Director of Business Transformation and Reader of Operations Management at Manchester Metropolitan University. Moderator for this session is my committee colleague and Branch Vice Chair, Mike Hammond. Welcome all and thank you for joining. Ian, would you like to start with some introductions?
Sure. Good afternoon, everyone. My name's Ian Reid. I've been interested in supply chain management from about since 2007. When I worked at the University of Liverpool, we were the first, and I think still remain the only CIPS accredited master's degree program in operations supply chain management. And as a scholar, but also a practitioner, I've always liked to continue working with companies and industries and looking at new challenges, but also, you know, putting theory back into practice, but also testing this practice back into theory. So this study, a lot of academics papers started to come out in about 2018, 2019. And I wanted to do almost a deeper dive within, you know, the supply chain and logistics kind of discipline to sort of see, well, actually, does this fall in line with current practice? But also the deeper dive, you know, where with panelists that might specialize purely on the quality side of it, may specialize purely in the procurement side of it, thinking, well, actually, do these wonderful tools and techniques sing true? But also, if there's an evolution going on, and especially with, you know, the recent pandemic, also with Brexit, of how businesses have to pivot and embrace these new technologies in order to remain competitive, connected, and almost, you know, tackling those operational challenges on a day-to-day basis. So yeah, there's a great opportunity. What I'm going to do for the next 25 minutes or so is really take you through a journey of this study. This study was commissioned just before Christmas, late 2019, and a lot of the data was collected in 2020, but all the results were gathered before COVID. So what we're going to do is look at this retrospectively, and I'm sure you've got lots of questions as we go through, so please feel comfortable to use the chat, and we'll tackle them as we go through. So yes, I'll kick off with the journey, and I'm sure there'll be some quite interesting findings as we go along. Slide. Okay, so we'll go back a bit. So there's a backstory here. I attended the Industry 4 Summit here in Manchester in March 2020, and it was very much, the analogy is almost going to the sweet shop. Lots of choices, lots of opportunities for a pick and mix scenario, but, you know, were people really knew exactly what they wanted? Now, was it the onboarding process to say, well, actually, what is the current level of adoption? But is it like you might have a problem that you need industry for or some of these digitalization offerings to either tackle a skills gap or the future of where you're taking your business? So I think everyone was overwhelmed with the tools and technologies that were currently available. In terms of actually making commitments, I think, you know, I think the jury was still out on this occasion, because I think if they've gone into cloud computing, they want to go, well, what's the next thing? Can we do the data analytics? Is our data clean? You know, can we get some smart sensors to help us to give you more accuracy in on our products or services that we offer? So it was very much, you know, a scene setting on the journey. Some people have committed to the journey already, and some people are still on the part of scoping things out. So a bit of background of the study itself. I did it with a colleague, Dr. John Hopkins. He's from Swinburne University down in Australia. Originally, we had 1,200 respondents, but because questionnaires can be quite timely, and we wanted to explore 16 different technology streams, to get a clean data set, we had 445 complete responses over 17 different sectors and 15 regions across the world. So it was very much this global study. My beloved colleague John had done a similar study in just Australia. So we're in the process of drawing comparisons between the UK and Australian kind of operations from that supply chain perspective. But as I've said before, I've worked with, and you can see from my bios, I've spent a lot of time with small, medium-sized enterprises where companies themselves have not got the funding or the resources or the capital to be very, to choose the most premium products like IBM Watson and their rules-based system. But it'd be also the opportunities to see, well, what can we do with what we've got? And so I spent taking best practice from the blue chip companies further down the supply chain to the small SMEs that play a really intricate part to that. So in terms of the demographics, as I've said, there were 445 respondents, but as we can see here, you know, we have got practitioners with over 30 years of experience. But because supply chain as a discipline evolves and fluctuates accordingly to our customer demands and so forth, the cluster of the population was really, you know, less than 14 years that contributed to about just over 50% of the respondents. In terms of the actual demographic, the 12% were locally. So you might work in supply chains within the region of, I don't know, Greater Manchester. You might operate more on a national level or regional level, but all those, but 50% of the respondents, so over half the survey was from an international audience. And the other thing we tried to contextualize, what was the turnover of these kinds of companies? So 26% of them had a turnover over $5 million US dollars. And you know, so there was an element of quite an SME population, but there was also the larger middle-sized organizations part of that survey. As you can see, you know, it's quite an extensive sample, but it was very much about trying to find out of, you know, the collective mix of practitioners and size of companies. Okay. So what was the core question? So we're trying to build a digital roadmap. So the questions are, you know, well, which technologies are actually changing the organization's network, the supply chain network? And we wanted to see if that landscape had changed. I will use the phrase blockchain because sometimes people see this as could be potential hype. But, you know, if you've got a digital ledger, you're into cryptocurrencies and so forth, you know, it might be very specific to the kind of businesses that you are. But we also wanted to look at the areas that will make you remain more competitive. If an organization is making a major step change into the digital landscape, you know, are these resources in-house? Are we having to get consultants in? Or are we having to retrain our employees and practitioners to this new way of thinking? So a practitioner that might have 28 years experience working in the supply chain to become more digitalized on the systems and tools and technologies that are available could be quite a challenge. And the final thing we're looking at is really how quickly do we need to onboard these specific technologies? So the areas of interest, most organizations in supply chain do have information technology. They might have an enterprise resource planning system or a management information system to try and pull a lot of the business functions together. So from sales to marketing to production to procurement to supply chain design, logistics and transportation. And it was interesting who was benefiting from what. A lot of the information from the study was drawing more onto the platform itself. Have you got the data? Is the data accessible to everybody? How is that data being manipulated? Are certain departments exploiting more of the data from the customer interface? Or is it very much of the end user perspective of saying, well, actually the goods are complete, it's ready for distribution, and the client wants to see where the products are going within its distribution network. So there was a number of areas of leverage But there was no real standout one apart from getting the information technology right in the first place. Oops. Let's go back a slide. Yeah. So the foundations, most of our respondents had the vision of cloud computing and big data. Cloud is really valuable in terms of if you're trying to pull your network of information together. However, within this particular slide, it was asking the questions, are the respondents considering the first step, the cloud computing scenario? And if so, when they were thinking of doing it? So most of them were actually had heard of cloud, had started maneuvering their existing systems from the exchange servers or data servers into moving into a cloud so it can fit better within the network. But then the next phase of when you start collecting all this data is what about the analytics to say, well, what is the data telling us? And there's loads of professions out there that have got lots of analytical tools, but is it helping them in their decision-making process going further forward? So that was the foundation. The challenges, you know, and what we were picking up from the survey result is people are building this platform. The big data analytics might feed into the machine learning. The machine learning feeds from data from your smart sensors and your IoT domain. But when you've got the machine learning and you've got the rules and you've got the smart thinking of assessing the decision-making process, you may be then incorporating aspects of AI. Now, the funny thing is with AI is currently available in most systems we already operate. There's AI in the Microsoft Office suite, for example. But there are individuals that were actually looking at more in a transactional process and maybe looking at how rules-based systems or machine learning or AI can help them in that blockchain scenario. So a lot of it is almost the onboarding of the technology, of almost a place for everything, but everything in the right place. And what these organizations are doing is getting the fundamentals of the cloud, analyzing the data to almost say, is this data clean? Is it accurate? Is it predictable? If it's predictable, they will build in the machine learning kind of capabilities. So you can see the kind of, we're very much, in my personal view, is that we're on a testing time of trying these things out. And it might be on the standard product ranges we offer, the standard services we offer. But the more bespoke and high levels of customization is becoming more of a particular challenge. Okay. So in terms of building this five-year road plan, this digital roadmap itself, and we've seen it in the press and we've seen it in a number of white papers and publication outlets, that autonomous vehicles, especially in the supply chain network, is becoming quite interesting. And it might be, everybody might be having their test bed of drones, robots, and so forth. Okay, can we move that back a bit? Okay, sorry. But it's also having this test bed of augmented reality, virtual reality, of testing the marketplace. And this marketplace might be just servicing our customers and our consumers. So we are almost using the sales arm of our organizations to promote the new technologies that we are considering or starting to make those initial steps in our research and development. So here's the question I've got for you. Is the five-year plan now under review? Now, because of COVID and COVID's actions and how we've had to pivot in response to COVID, does the five-year plan actually exist now? Does the five-year plan, has it been shortened? Because we've probably read that we were going to do this in 5 years, but we've had to do it in 6 months because of the issues of COVID. So one of the things we wanted to ask you as our audience, our first poll, is, you know, has COVID, you know, refocused your technology? Is that okay? Now, do I hand that over to yourself, Mike, to facilitate that, or? So the question we wanted to ask you in a poll is, you know, has COVID changed your focus of technology? Because as I go through this information, this was a pre-COVID scenario. So if you focused on one particular aspect of, you know, if it was cloud computing, or if you're now thinking of moving into drones.
Yeah, so the poll should now be up here. So
wonderful. Thank you, Mike. Yeah. So it's really getting a consensus to say, have you had to pivot and pivot a lot quickly? And that five-year plan is maybe reduced to saying, well, this is what we're going to have to do in the next 18 months in response to a global pandemic. So that's the first poll we wanted to ask you.
Okay,
and we know that things have changed. Okay, let me go back a bit. Sorry. And like Industry 4 is a network. And that network is offered lots of information. That information that could be formalized data. That data drives your information. And that information may be very much, just jumping back a bit, sorry about the technology, okay. And that information itself might be feeding your enterprise resource planning, and it might feed into your 3D printing of a prototype or a development. But it might be giving you data on your customer and consumer behavior. Or if you've got, you're analyzing your products out in the field and you're doing preventative maintenance programs. This network is complex and you might be dealing with legacy data. You might have to clean that data and it has to be compatible across all your systems. So if you've got a robot cell, do all the robots talk to each other? Do they learn from their mistakes and feed into that more localized network to say, if you do the product again, there are lessons learned. Technology is expensive. And one of the challenges because of COVID is, where do we invest? Is it the last mile logistics is now the biggest challenge? Is it the element, so we like with the pharmaceutical supply chains and the distribution of PPE, that we might think, well, how are we getting to the end user? How often, for example, have we got forgotten the face mask and we're about to go on public transport? So we had a project with a vending machine company that actually uses machine learning to tell us how much PPE equipment is being consumed within these vending machines that sit on platforms or in highly density kind of regions within our cities. The network is complex, and the goal is one of saving time, cost, manpower, reduction in errors, but we also need to create those efficiencies. And as I said, the eye is on the price. So whatever you do as an organization, it has to be tailored to fit the model that you're looking for. And it's back to the very first slide of where you're in this pick and mix scenario within the Industry 4 suite to say, well, which tools and techniques do we need to invest first? What is the onboarding and how we go further forward? So, let me go back a slide. So out of the 16 tools, and I'll let you scan through those, everything that was written in blue is very much, has not changed. So the demand on cloud has continued from the beginning of this study, but also for future thinking. Everything that I highlighted in red, so if you look at blockchain and procurement and contracts and warehousing, this is what people are looking at from the as-is model. This is what we're doing today. So robots for manufacturing and production, collaborative robots to end consumer cobots. So, you know, to have a website instead of having a person manning the phones for your Q&A questions, they use a chat box or a cobot to help deliver the communication to our customers' perspective, because customers want answers now. They're not prepared to wait as much as what they may have used to. So one of the things that we wanted to do then, well, if this is the as-is model, what's the future looking? And the future is looking in a number of perspectives. If you look at the top right with VR and AR, it's very much, it was about the end user experience, the onboarding of the client or the customer. But as we've gone on and we talk about the 2 year or 5 year plan, we're using these technologies more in warehousing, in our inventory management. And the funny scenario was that I looked on LinkedIn today and there was a guy with his tablet or his phone taking a picture of stock control, and there was an AR machine, there was a VR kind of capability, no, an AR capability. And it automatically did the stock check of what was on the pallet or what was in stock. So we are using technology to help in real-time data to be more accurate, such as on order picking. The thing at the bottom, you know, we're driving the smart sensors, the IoT, You know, we are moving not from just the quality control, because that's what the sensors used to do on the lines or on the packaging, but it would might be looking more at the transportation logistics. You know, where is the vehicle within the network? Has it arrived at its distribution center? When is it going to be unloaded? And so we're using more of the technology, not just for quality, but for greater visibility. So the things that I've highlighted are the kind of themes. So IoT is the big player in today's world of where we're looking at, you know, from forecasting and demand planning of how we're using the smart sensors to give us this real-time data to feed into our facilities. And whether it's having smarter robots moving from manufacturing production into warehouse and inventory management, like order picking and so forth, and having autonomous vehicles within that picking scenario. But it might be moving into that warehouse inventory management. So there are things that are changing and there are themes that are becoming more popular. So the second question I've got within our poll,
Trying to manage the poll for you and clicking the wrong thing.
Okay, don't worry, sorry.
So do you want to see the results of the last poll? I guess that'd be quite interesting.
Yes, that'd be great, thank you.
I'll just pop those up so everyone should be able to, that should come up now, yep, here okay. We go. So we can see that the vast majority of people actually sees that there is a change in focus. I think interesting to share that back to the audience and also to yourself as well, Ian.
Thank you very much. That's really helpful. Thank you.
And for the next poll then, let me just pop that one back up. Right. Okay. Something gone wrong here. I apologize. The second question seems to have disappeared. Okay, got it now. Right, here we go. So I launched that poll now, so that should come up on everyone's screen. They should be able to answer that now and give people a few seconds and then we'll put those results up as well.
Okay, so whilst that's calculating up, well, I can move on. So we know COVID has changed our business models to some extent or even to a greater extent, but it'd be nice to see what the poll actually indicates for us. Okay, so let's move on to the next one. So the game changers, as I said before, the main element of the industry for the drivers to change is almost the customer's demands. Us as customers, oops, let me just get the slide back again. Okay. As the customer changes its demand, there is a focus of where we are dealing with almost the external interface into our organization. But as a result of that, it puts far more pressure on our operational capabilities because we want to remain competitive. We want to be agile and nimble in terms of the responsiveness to our particular customer base and client base. But if you look at the actual numbers themselves, that 91% is the driver of the customer demands because they want more transparency, more realization of the products and service we offer. But it might be all down to the detail of the data. It's that real-time data accurate for us to give us forecasting, predictability, and so forth. So one of the things we've got to do here is, you know, technology is a wonderful thing. And the technology itself, it's funny how, let me just take it back. Yeah. You know, we know as individuals that we might not be experts within all those domains of those 16 kind of disciplines of Industry 4. But what we want it to do is help us in our decision making. So one of the things we're looking at is these Industry 4 is looking at trying to help us in these complex decision making, whether it's forecasting, whether it's looking at internal resources, actually getting transparency from our people management in our systems, our rules that we adopt. But as a knockoff, we have to manage that immersion intelligence. You know, how easy was it for the onboarding somebody's work practices to start using technology to inform our decision-making? And whether we've got to then make it, so, well, actually it's made me smarter because I have more data at my fingertips. I've got more predictive analytics helping my decision-making process. How well is it feeding our network? And it might be, you know, key parts. And like I said, the responders, you know, they're looking at negotiation is helping judgment on decision making. And it might be helpers on our creative, our marketing drive of selling some of the products and services that we offer. So I wanted to add that, because that was, you know, when the computer says no, well, what do we need to do to understand why the computer is saying no? So where is the investment? So if you're focused very much on the data analytics, and an organization might have employed a data scientist, whether there was a contract or there's somebody dedicated in building the data infrastructure, but also collecting the data, interpreting the data, disseminating that data to those key individuals. But the big data has been used in the contract management. So blockchain, for example, might be to manage contracts, to make us smarter in our T's and C's, our terms and conditions. But it might be to do with our transportation logistics network. So the themes that were coming out of the 445 respondents were filtering into these four core themes. For the blockchain, contract management, robotics, purely on the manufacturing, the assembly and material handling and product development, but in from the IoT, the smart sensors, the data is almost looking at transparency of data from remote locations or within our physical distribution centers and so forth. So there were a couple of, these are where people are investing from based on the number of respondents. So one of the conclusions are, in the number of cases, while certain technologies were expected to impact particular organizations and sector, investment predictions for those technologies are surprisingly low by comparison. And that is probably down to that 5-year scenario. If people are doing that strategic plan of 5 years, there is time to consider or reconsider their options. But because of COVID, we might have had to accelerate that decision-making process. And our preparatory measures might be actually looking at, we've got to go for more of the digital disruption, such as, the virtual factory, the flexible working conditions, better work-life balance scenarios for our network that are involved in this particular supply chain or distribution network. Those observations have practical implications for both our supply chain managers, so it might help us inform the decision-making, not just purchasing the capital equipment, but it might be, have we got the right people to give us this service offering? So do we need a data analyst that can do the analytics or create the machine learning for the rules-based system that we want for that particular core product, which gives us the greatest return on investment? So organizations are horizon scanning, looking at the productivity levels of where the technology can help them in their efficiencies, but also the investment of internal upskilling of the training courses in the suite of offerings of Industry 4. But if we can't do it in-house and we need to accelerate, the conversion of being capable to offer these particular tools and technologies, we are pivoting our business model to have new hires and experts come into our organization. And one of the final things I wanted to show you, because I am an academic, of people can reach out to universities and the kind of research that we do to almost help the chess pieces in the game of this industry forward, to help us in that forward planning or horizon scanning, to say, well, this is our business. We do a variety of products. We distribute it across our whole value stream. What is the onboarding process of which pieces should be put in the right order to make this the greatest return on our investment? Okay, and that kind of concludes the presentation. As I said, I've been doing this for about a couple of years now, or it's longer than that. With working with CIPS, it's been about 10 years. So I've been a member across the network, but the Industry 4 thing has been going on for about 4 years. So happy to take any questions, and I hope you enjoyed the journey from the survey's findings.
Thank you very much, Ian. That was amazingly useful, and I'm very, very happy to see that not only do we have so many participants, but we have also a number of questions. Please ensure that you transfer all your questions from the chat box to the Q&A box, so we can have full visibility and we're able to reply to all of them.
Okay,
so Michael, would you like to?
Yeah, thanks very much. We're getting to the Q&A session now. Before we go there, I just thought it'd be useful to share the outcome of the second poll. So I'll just put that up on the screen. Okay, so the question was around, has COVID changed the timeline for technology investments by your organization? So for the majority, the timeline has shortened, but there's also a number where it's also lengthened, and there's some where there's no change. So less conclusive than the first poll, but it does show the impacts of COVID on decision-making, particularly around technology investments. So I think very useful to just to share that, maybe give you some additional insight when we get to the Q&A now. So the first question I've got up on the Q&A is, it's for you, Ian, and it's an interesting one. Which technology excites you the most, Ian, and why is the question?
Okay, so it's a difficult one because I probably have two choices. I think for the times I've worked with businesses of getting really good, clean data, I'm very much interested in that machine learning, you know, the variables that can help everyone's decisions. I came from an engineer to order background where you had to get it right first time. So, and if you made a mistake, it's very expensive. And in terms of time, labor, or it could be, you know, a complaint, or you're punished by your client. So I think the machine learning has got a whole load of avenues to penetrate, because if we can get, you know, the predictive elements right, we can get a better forecast, we can get better behavioral analytics of the products and services we offer. So that was one. But, you know, in terms of the wizardry and the technology itself, I like the VR and AR attributes are phenomenal. I went onto, there's an app called WannaKix, and it basically, you can order a pair of shoes, or, you know, you can look at a pair of shoes and they present them sitting on your feet. So you can look at a pair of trainers thinking, do these look good on me? And it will automatically do it for you because it's took a scan of your foot and it will almost superimpose the trainer on your foot. So I think for showcasing products and services, the VR and AR is definitely something to look at in the future, especially if you're used to the more traditional ways of seeing a potential client or customer, and you meet them, you take them for lunch, you need more wizardry in getting new customers over the line.
Okay,
no, so thanks. I've answered your question, but I've gone for two options.
Yeah, no, thanks very much for that. Yeah. Okay, moving on to the next question. It's from a gentleman called Egbert Smith, who I do know. And Egbert's asking, can you provide some practical examples how blockchain can help with contract management and what blockchain references would be required in the contract with the supplier? Have you got any experience of that, Ian?
No, what I've picked up from the blockchain scenario is almost the reliability of the individuals in the block. And sometimes, you know, the transactional process can slow things down. So you could, if you've got standard contracts and they're smart contracts and they're done through mass transactions, there is a fit. But if you're tweaking contracts all the time, you need to make sure the block is happy with it. And the delay in the block for almost authentication of the block is called gas. And there's a great paper by Samir Dani and Abdul Jabbar, which looks at the time frame of the transaction, but also the cost of processing for the transaction time, which is called gas. So I think it depends on the complexity of the terms and conditions of that contract. Now, if it's in its purest form of a digital ledger, then it has a fit. But it all depends on the amount of information that is part of that contract.
Okay, thanks very much for that, Ian.
Okay.
Next question is from Emma Soddards. I hope I'm pronounced that correctly. Emma says, first of all, thanks for the presentation. Emma's been working in procurement for years and now working for a software company that has a total end-to-end solution for managing food safety, suppliers and procurement in one platform. So bearing in mind the huge benefits, time, resources, costs, data insights that can be gleaned from this kind of technology and the results of the poll, Ian, do you think the decision makers in business really want to invest in digital transformation at this time? As much of the feedback that Emma's getting from potential customers that they're too busy to look at anything new. And that seems a little bit like a catch 22.
And okay, so you could, if I was looking at my business model, and if you're maintaining survival as well as growth, you might think that the system doesn't need tweaking. You don't play about with it. But the key factor, you know, one thing I haven't mentioned is quality. If there's new legislation coming in, if there's new guidelines that we have to adhere to, it's not just the cost, time and money, it's the quality protection of that food safety supply chain in its own right. So if it was, when products and branding of food products needed to look at all the dietary conditions in its packaging design, you know, you might be then forced to adapt your technology to cater for something that is outside your discipline. Does that make sense? So if legislation changes, your products will have to pivot accordingly. Now, and if you feel like your product is, you know, so there is a model by Hales and Wheelwright to say, are you in the business where you're firefighting? Are you in the business where actually, you know, people look at us and they look at the way we operate? So when people look at Amazon in terms of looking at their distribution network, you know, are we defining the marketplace? So a good scenario is you benchmark against your competitors of, you know, what they may be doing. What are we doing? What could we do differently that might make our products or services the order delighters or the order winners? Because a lot of it you've got to qualify for anyway. But the hardest thing is if, you know, the marginal gains of incorporating technology. So you just might want to incorporate smarter IoT sensors to look at the stage gates through that supply chain. That might be the only thing you might want to do is the real-time data, because you could check it purely on the service, but how is the service behaving? So if it was, you know, if your product is really popular and the demand is going through the roof, can you still control it? Because if you can control it, you can predict it. And what gets measured gets done. So if you're happy with the measurements you've got, then great, it's not a problem. But if there were elements of where the chain breaks down, that might become your bottleneck within the system of where you might think we need to get better data out of it just to see how it's behaving. And a lot of it could be more of the behavioral operations of that supply chain rather than the whole supply chain itself. I hope that answers the question.
Okay, thanks very much, Ian. The next question is from Tamur Shafiq, and it's regarding delivery of AI and IoT. And the question is, what kind of lab setup should be required? So Tamur is intending to invest in an advanced AI and IoT lab, but not sure what kind of equipment or tools should be included. Is that something you can give some insight into there?
I could try and do my best. I have a company that specializes in pesticides, and they're doing a lot of R&D development. I think before you do the investment, you probably have to look at what data you currently what kind of data you currently have, and whether you've got a data scientist to look at the behavioral models of that data. That might help you in that decision making of where you want to do, because, you know, the AI might be driven by sales and marketing data. The AI could be driven by the product itself. So if you've got smart sensors or, you know, tagging on your product. So if you take, you know, the development process of products and transparency of products and test results of those products, then, you know, to me, it's all about what is the data saying first? What kind of element of the data are you really interested in? Is it the behavior at test? Is it the behavior of selection? So if you're looking at almost like the new product development, It could be, you know, you might be looking at features, you might be looking at the geometric size of it, you might be the aesthetic. So if I nutshell, look at data, but look at the terms of your value proposition. What value do you want? Is it aesthetics? Is it to do with, you know, the mechanics of how it works? Is it about the cost? There's a couple of things in terms of value that is worth looking at. I can't remember off my top of my head. But in that lab scenario, you might need data that's very much for the client and end user, but you might need data from design to manufacture. So you need the manufacturing and process capability data coming through. I don't know if that answers your question, but I suppose it's AI is one thing, but like as I've said, you know, you've got to almost generate the bag of words in machine learning to say, well, what you're looking at. Is it, where is this product going to go? What is this product made of? What is this service requirement of through its process capabilities? Within AI and machine learning, it's usually the bag of words that you are collecting and you're analyzing almost the occurrence of where these words come from to give you direction where you want to take it. So a data scientist is probably your best individual to kind of look at your data. Your data will give you information. Your information will now give you knowledge and hopefully more of that predictability element that you're looking for.
Okay, that's great though. Thanks. Thanks okay. So much. A question here from Mayank Yan. So you come from the rotating industry. So which area does this technology impact in that kind of long lead engineer to order supply chain? So a question based on your experience of
I used to work in oil and gas, and I used to do centrifugal pumps. Lead time for products were about 42 weeks. One of the problems we had is these projects had a post-mortem at the end of life cycle almost, or the end of product of when it's commissioned and installed and so forth. On what the data was saying to me was, you need to almost have a stage gate before the product becomes physical. What I mean by that is when you put the nuts and bolts on it kind of thing, you're committing your design cost before you're making anything. So if I was going to do machine learning, it's almost how well is, you've got two things of the kickoff meeting of the project. What have you promised your client? Because it's a one-off. The customer says, we would like it to do this. You've issued a letter of intent. This is what we're going to make for you. It's all about compliance before you actually start making it. So I would use, but it's also, you've got two things, you've got three things going in engineer to order, is the tendering and handover to the project when it kicks off. You've got your test data for when you're trialing before it leaves your factory, and you've got your commissioning data when it's out in the field. I would look at opportunities to collect data from out of the field, to look at lessons learned, to feed all the way back into your tendering process. Because if you say this product is very similar to this person or this contract we did 2 years ago, what were the lessons learned in its life cycle? What do we need to warn the design guys of, if you're going to commit with these, this is some of the operational characteristics, because most organizations will have data from the customer spec and the test results. And I think you need to get bigger. And if you can get real-time data out of the field, and because you might have said that this product has, you know, its operating life cycle is 26,000 hours. How are they utilizing it? Are they, you know, it's like people who have a washing machine that wash everything morning, noon, and night. And the life cycle is not 5 years, it goes down to 3.5 because it's used so many more hours in its estimated lifespan. So look at the touch points, the critical phases, and I would say two or three of them before the product becomes physical. Look at the product when it's tested, and look at data when it's out in the field. Does that help?
That's great, though. Thanks, Ian.
Okay.
So next question from Raj, and Irina, you might be able to help with this one as well. It's, are there any additional considerations around data confidentiality we should monitor or measure when utilizing tech within businesses?
Yeah, so a lot of people who invest, right, if people have moved a lot of their sensitive data into the cloud, you know, that the worry is the cybersecurity. It's whether it's farther from the hacker's domain, you know, the confidentiality agreement stuff. You're right. I think it's, you know, it's how you protect if your sensitive document is really probably out of my control. But in terms of, you know, from a professional service element, the document readers are key, but it's the cybersecurity on protecting those key documents, especially if they're floating around a lot within the cloud itself, with, you know, within across your business units. So to answer your question, it's probably quite a difficult one to answer. As long as, you know, if you feel like you're, you know, that those documents are super sensitive, that might be one of the trade-offs that you have to encounter. Instead of, you know, Industry 4 has a suite of offerings, but if you think the confidentiality and safety of our documents is more paramount, then you might spend more time on the cloud computing or the blockchain, the digital side of it. So I suppose, yeah, it's a difficult one, to be honest.
Yeah, okay. Irene, is there anything you want to add from your perspective?
I presume that it depends, in the specific, it depends also on the type of the industry, and not only about the amount, but also on the type of documents and the data they are managing. So I presume that this is a more industry specialized element that if they are used to handle and manage classified the document, very sensitive document, that they should have taken already, no matter what we're discussing now, this appropriate safety to apply safety practices, isn't it, in order to ensure this confidentiality. So I think that this could be associated, and you cannot always add another level of security level, but in any case, it should be as part of the general risk management of this data.
Okay, thanks, Irene. I think that really helps in that add. Thank you. I've got a great question here from Adam Pritchard. So Ian, do you find this development appearing in the public sector, i.e. for councils, police forces, etc., or is it more within the private sector? Public versus private.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of lessons from the public sector, and it's probably going on similar to the last question. Is, you know, if you're a professional service and a lot of documentation is really critical for the protecting the evidence base, I think there are a lot of advantages in how we are using this data to protect our documents, but also the predictability of those documents, or even generating scenarios. So, you know, if you worked in manufacturing and you work in make to stock, or if you work in banking and you do mass transactions, you can learn through repetition. If you're a consultancy service, and like if you're a financial advisor, or if you were working in engineer to order and their bespoke products, there are far more scenarios you need to consider, because the variables of change or difference is far greater. So the lessons I would say is, in terms of looking at machine learning, predictive analytics, it's a lot more comfortable in those mass transactions, make to stock kind of environment. As soon as you start decoupling into higher levels of customization, you think this is a one-off and it's particularly for that customer. It's, you know, the only thing that is going to be repetitive is the type of process, but not the content. So I believe in three key things: context, content, and process. The moment you might use Industry 4 purely to help standardize your processes, but the context can make all the difference. And therefore the context might define, is the content quite simplified? Lots of repetition, you know, you might be serving the same community or customer base all the time. But if you're working in new markets, new clients, the behavior might be different. So there were maybe more offerings of where it might not, there's far greater risk in that scenario of where it's more bespoke. And whether, you know, you worked in, you know, Manchester City Council and you're issuing contracts for, you know, recycling or sustainability projects, you might think, well, actually, it's a rollout of the contract. So you might develop blockchain because it's all about the repetition side of it. It's not going to change that much. But if it's a new government incentive and it's like issuing new contracts to do with HS2, well, actually, well, this scenario is slightly different. You know, we are about to go through a medieval burial ground. What are our options? What do we need to respect? What do we need to consider? There are other scenarios you have to build on board, but you might then see it as a business model. So we're the experts in land registry that can support HS2 for when we're going through medieval excavations for archaeologists or something like that. That's when you customize your model. Does that help answer the question?
I think so. It does, Ian. Thank you. Thank you. So a question from Dr. Mahib. He says it's probably an academic question, but thinks it's still relevant.
I know this guy.
Yeah, I thought you might do. Do you think the technology adoption response to COVID is strategic? And did business models change to accommodate this?
Okay. The answer to Mahib is I think ideally they would like to think it's strategic, but it's probably more tactical. The people have seen the COVID as an opportunity to pivot their business models. And whether, you know, they're experts in 3D printing and they actually said, well, actually we can easily duplicate this because it's just, we've got a design and we can solve the patent out for this PPE equipment across our network. So it, you know, it's because of, and it might be, you know, the kind of equipment you need in the COVID scenario, whether it was to do with defibrillators, you know, additional breathing sort of products, it might need an extra level of customization, but a lot of SMEs are benefiting from this because they've been able to pivot their business model because it's all about flexibility, responsiveness, and almost maybe closer to that localized community that needs these products and services, where the bigger companies are almost like the super tanker scenario, where it's a lot more difficult to actually change the way they work, unless they've got almost decoupled centers of excellence, like an R&D center, say, we can work on this. So, but then you might be raising more questions to the governance system and how these organizations are looking after opportunity, because the first thing you might do is let us see if you can secure a contract. You gradually scale up accordingly and to almost stress test the system that you're adopting. So I would say ideally they think it's like blue sky thinking and very strategic, but to me it's more of an operational tactical approach of where they just, you know, pivoting in different for those opportunities.
And sharing some thoughts on this. What I understand is that all of these, even if we recognize them as necessary, fall to the nice to have elements within a business ecosystem, isn't it? And at the same time, there is an inconsistency across industries on how they manage their data. So even if we may have some more progressive companies that they may invest, they still need to compromise using basic or hybrid practices.
Yeah, I totally, like I said, when I add a deeper dive into those 16 technologies, I know I brought this slide back up, of, you know, it's part of the evolution chain, where you might have had the smart sensors for your quality controls, it might be then using the similar smart sensors almost to stock and replenishment management, but then that might feed into cobots that feed in to looking your inventory management, that might feed in then into your ERP systems or manufacturing execution systems. So, you know, there's a chain of evolution. It's the same when I said about, you know, the big data analytics, and if I go up to the other slide, this one, you know, you might be dealing with this first. So your Internet of Things is giving you really valuable data. But what do you do with it? The NHS, for example, measures lots and lots of processes, lots of trust and lots of networks. The hardest challenge is using machine learning capabilities. Well, what do you want to investigate? And it might be to a company's or a trust strategic KPIs. And we have to delve a lot deeper. So if it's all about the number of beds that are available, it might be the utilization of beds within a trust. They might use machine learning on the predictive analytics to say, well, when are the hospitals busiest? Can we then almost design a control mechanism to say, well, how are we gonna resource the bottleneck within our network is the number of beds available? And they might use AI to help that decision-making process. So a lot of it, you can kind of cluster from data, information to knowledge, and then, you know, the wisdom is the AI capability.
Thanks. Unfortunately, we're running out of time now. There are a couple more questions, which I don't think we're going to be able to get to. So, but we will come back to you and provide answers offline. So sure. Apologies if we didn't get to your question. But can I hand back to Irini to just really close the session and give some more information about what's going on in the future, please?
Thank you very, very much, Ian and Mike. Just a very quick insight to full information for following events from our side. 16th of February, Build Back Better, how high speed 2 will lead the UK's post-pandemic, will lead the UK's post-pandemic economic recovery. We have Andy Cross, Rail Systems Procurement Director with us. 23rd of February, Brexit event. And last but not least, we're delighted to announce our new initiative, Breakfast in Manchester, with that is a series of breakfast gatherings to discuss topics of members' interest. These gatherings will have a more relaxed character, and we will be able to discuss together areas of your interest, like interview tips, how to make your CV stand out, how to find a job in the COVID, post-COVID era, etc. The list is definitely non-exhaustive, and the participants will be able to share their thoughts about the topic of the next gathering. So every time we will have a guest, you can also suggest who you would like us to invite to share experience and valuable ideas. Definitely not a sales pitch. And having said that, we're delighted to confirm our first breakfast in Manchester with John Warrior and Josh Cable from Hayes. All friends that will share their views and answer questions on the regional job market post-COVID. So please join us on our LinkedIn page. We are tweeting, and we will share more information shortly. Thank you very, very much for joining us. Thank you for staying a little bit longer with us, and we'll see you next time. Stay safe. Thank you, Ian, once again, and Mike, for your support.
You're very welcome. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Bye-bye. Thanks, Ian. Thanks, really.